How's it going? I'm Scott Moss and I'm your instructor for this course, which is an introduction to Node.js version 2. I really love Node. I remember the first time I learned it, being able to transfer my JavaScript skills over to server side really leveled me up as an engineer. So in this course, I'm going to be showing you some of those things that I've learned from creating command line interfaces, APIs, and interacting with the file system. All the things that you need to level yourself up as a full stack or a backend engineer. I had a ton of fun creating this course and I hope you enjoy it too. Let's make some modules. So if we go back into our file here, and we have a piece of code here, let's call it action. It's a function. Right now, this is just a piece of code. It's just a function. It doesn't really do anything. I'm just logging hello. And I could run this in the browser. I could also run this in Node, and it would work the same. It doesn't do anything. I'm not even calling the function. But the difference is, if I wanted to share this action function with another JavaScript file somewhere else in my application, in the browser, by having this just in the file right now, it's going to be attached to the global, so I can access it via window in the next JavaScript file. But in Node.js, there is no window. And nothing gets attached to the global space by default because all of your files inside of Node.js actually get encapsulated in their own little module, so they don't leak. It's not going to get attached to the window by default. So what you have to do here to be able to expose this piece of code, that way it can be used in another module, another file, is that you have to explicitly say, I want this piece of code to be a module. I want it to be usable somewhere else. I want to export it. So with the common JS syntax, you would see something like this. You would see module.exports equals, and then whatever you wanted to export. So in this case, I want to export the action function. And what this allows me to do is, in another file, and I can call it app.js. I can say const action equals require, which is another global. It's a function, and it takes a relative path to another JavaScript file that you want to bring into this JavaScript file. So relative to the app.js, I want to include index. And I don't have to put JS here if it's a JS file. You're going to find out we're probably going to use a different type of file that we do have to put an extension. But if it's for common JS and it's a JS file, you don't have to put the extension. You can just exclude it, and it will work. So now, inside of here, I'm able to have access to that action function, and I can call it. I'm going to save both of these files. I'm going to go over to my Node, my terminal here. I'm going to run Node. Instead of running it against the index.js file, which just creates the function and exports it, I'm actually going to run it against the app.js file, which requires the index file and executes it there. So it's kind of like creating a dependency tree, like a graph almost of dependencies. So I'm going to run it against app. And as you can see, it does execute the action function, which caused the log there. So we were able to share this action function here to this app.js by using this module.exports. So module.exports can pretty much export whatever you want. I could have wrapped this in a function, an object if I wanted to. I could have done however I wanted to export this. You might also see, not so common anymore, you'll see some people do like exports.action, which is the equivalent of doing something like module.exports and wrapping it in an object. You don't really see this anymore, so I don't recommend doing that. I recommend just always using module.exports at the bottom of your file somewhere and then exporting the things that you want to be export. And the things that you don't want to be export, you just don't include them here, and that way they're private to this file. Like I said, this is called common JS, and this is what's been the standard for Node.js for quite some time. It's what ships with Node.js. It's the default module syntax for Node.js. But we're going to use the newer one because that's the future of Node.js. It's the future of the browsers. It's the attempt of all the browser people and the Node.js people coming together and be like, okay, how do we simplify this? How do we make it to where JavaScript is truly universal across environments? How about we start with the modules? How about we get on board with the latest module syntax that's been adopted by the JavaScript ecosystem for quite some time now? And that's going to be called the ES modules or ECMAScript modules. So that's what we're going to be using in this course because we have access to it on version 14. So that's what we're going to do. In fact, I think it was introduced in maybe version 10. Don't quote me on that, but it's been here since version 14. So in order to do that, a couple things we have to do. First, we have to tell Node.js what version of modules that we want. And there's a few ways we can do it. We can be explicit by using the .mjs extension. I know, another file extension, I get it. You know, I was kind of skeptical to .jsx and then .tsx and all this stuff. Like, why can't I just use JS for everything? But yes, MJS, which is module.js, is an extension that you can use. And by doing that, you're going to let Node know that, hey, I'm using ES modules in this file. So use that instead of the .js. Another way you can do it is you can actually go into what's called a package.json, which we will talk about. And you can just say, I want to use type, you know, ECMA, ES modules or whatever in here. And it will still allow you to use the .javascript extension, .js extension, but also opt in for the ES modules. We're going to keep it simple and just be explicit. That way, we don't confuse ourselves. We don't, you know, we're not in a place where we're not really sure what modules are being loaded. We'll just use .mjs for all of our files going forward in this course, so we know what's being used as far as the modules go. So to get back to our code, so we looked at what this looks like if we were to export using CommonJS. Now let's look at what this will look like if we were to export using ECMAScript modules or ESM. So we still have our function here. We can get rid of this. And instead, we could just put the word export in front of it, not to be confused with exports, which is CommonJS. Exports is a CommonJS thing that allows you to do exactly this. Exports, and you would get rid of this const, I'm sorry. You would say exports.action. But the word export, without the S, not plural, can be placed before like a variable declaration like this. And it's now going to expose this variable to be able to be imported in another file. So we're going to save that. But this also creates what's called a named export. And the reason it's called a named export is because when you import it over here in this file, I have to import it by the name of the variable that comes after the exports word. So in this case, it was called action, because that was the name of the variable, from index. And this should still work. So we replace the require function with this import keyword. Because it's a named export, we have to wrap it across. We have to wrap the brackets around it to actually get the name. And then we use the from keyword followed by the relative path to this file to the module that we want to import. So now we'll do that. And then lastly, we need to rename these to MJS. So we have to say MJS, and this has to be MJS. So once we get that, we can save them, we can save it, we can go back to our code, and now I can run Node against MJS, and we still get the same result. We get hello. Let's go back to our server, and let's import Express from Express, and we'll import what was it? Oh yeah, body parser. I'm just call it BP from body parser, and then import Morgan from Morgan. So we got all of those. Now with Express, we need to create an app. So we'll say app equals Express like that. So now we have our app. And then we want to go ahead and set up our middleware first, and then followed by our routes. And then lastly, we will open the server. We'll listen, and we'll be good to go. So let's set up our middleware. So we want to, the way we can do that is we can say app.use. That's a method. And we can pass in an array of middleware. We can pass in one middleware. This is, we can make one in line right here with an anonymous function. We're going to use body parser. I'm going to say BP. And I'll actually want to use something called URL encoded. And I'm going to pass in an option that says extended true. Basically, what this is going to have, what this is going to give us is if someone passes some data on a query string, it's going to parse that for us. And it basically just makes sure that we can parse the query string and whatever's in the URL pretty easily. We probably won't be using this in this example, but it's useful. And then the other one we want to do is app.use bp.json. This one we will be using. This one allows us to parse the JSON body of a post request so we can actually see it as JSON and not like bits of chunks that we have to add together like we did in the HTTP server. And the last one we want to do is Morgan. So we say Morgan, and we're passing dev. It's just a type of logging that you want. I think there's different options here. Let's see. So you can pass in I don't know. There's like different formats you can do. We're just gonna pass in dev here. Maybe if I take this away, it'll show me. Let's see. Yeah, there's like combined, some other options. I always just use dev because it's the shortest one. Just give me the simplest amount of information. So now that we got our middleware, we need to set up some routes. Before we do that, let's like create a little database where we can store our to-dos. So I'm gonna say db equals an array. And now we're going to set up some routes. So I want a route to where if I post to slash to-dos, it'll create a new to-do and add it to the database and then send that back. And if I do a get request to slash to-dos, it will just send me back all the to-dos. So I'm going to say app dot followed by the verb that I want. So in this case, I want to do the post. So app dot post, that's a method. First argument is going to be the path that I want to receive. I said I want to-dos, so I'm going to say to-dos. And then I'm just going to say to-do, actually. Keep it singular. And then whatever controller, you can think of this as like, what callback do you want to run when someone does this post request, OK? And just like the HTTP server, because guess what? Express uses the HTTP server underneath it. We get this request and response object. And you'll see this pretty much in every single Node.js server implementation, whether it's Express or Happy or whatever server framework you use, they pretty much all use request response. That's because they're all using the HTTP module, which uses request and response. So it's very common to see this pattern. So we're going to say, OK, cool. We want to first grab this to-do and add it to the database. So let's do that. So we'll say new to-do. And that's going to equal an object. We'll just say the ID is, I don't know, date.now. So I don't like incremented IDs. And then the text is going to be whatever is on the request.body.text. So that means someone's going to post an object to this server. And that object is going to have a text property on it. And the value of that text property is going to be whatever is going to be saved here in the to-do. And that's it. So now we got our new to-do. I'm going to say db.push our new to-do here, like that. And I'm going to say res.json new to-do. And that simple, I was able to create a to-do, push it in our database, and then respond back really simply. So we're going to do the same thing before a get request. So I'm going to say app.get slash to-do. Remember, a route is a combination of a verb and a path. The verb here is a post. The path is to-do. The verb here is get, but the path is also to-do. So although they're both the same routes, they're different paths because this has a get verb associated with it. So it's going to only be activated when someone does a get request to this route or to this path. So request, response, and then for a get request, all we want to do is just say res.json db. Let's just show all the to-dos. That's pretty much it. And the next thing is we want to start our server so we can listen on it. So we'll say app.listen. Looks familiar, right? If we go back to here, isn't that what we did here? Server.listen. It's really, like I said, an abstraction around the HTTP module, which already does this. So we'll say app.listen. We don't have to pass in a host here. It'll default to localhost for us or whatever host you're on. And we just need to give it a port. So I'm going to just give it the same port of 8000. And it does take a callback optionally if you want to use that. And we'll just pretty much do the same thing. Console.log server on HTTP, localhost, 8000. So we'll do that. And that's going to be our server. And let's do a post request. So I'm going to start the server again. I'm going to use my HTTP pi. And I'm going to do a post request to slash to-do. And I'm going to post the text property. So this text says I need to eat more food today. I don't eat enough. I should eat more than I actually am. I have to be too busy. I don't know. So we'll do that. And you can see I get a 200. And it sends back this JSON object. It says, here's the ID, which I put date.now, and then our text. So I'm going to add some more. Clean up my closet. I just throw my clothes at the bottom of the closet sometimes, so I need to clean it up. There we go. So we got two to-dos now. The server is still running. If you look at these nice little pretty logs we have, this is Morgan. This is that middleware that's logging this for us. So you can see we had one request come in. It was a post to slash to-do. status code 200, and it took 3.60 milliseconds to function. I have no idea what this number is with Morgan, but I'm guessing it's some time or something. And then the other one took even less. So super fast, as you can see, and this is just a local machine. It's, you know, doing really good here. Now let's actually see if we can pull those to-dos down with the GET request. And before we do it, the server hasn't stopped. It's been running this whole time. So, and I was pushing those to-dos to an array. So that means I'm anticipating that because this server is still running, and because I pushed them to an array, that those objects should still be floating in memory right now. They should still be sitting around waiting for me to pull them down. And that would only happen if the server was still running and it didn't stop like our other node programs did. So let's prove that theory. And let's do a GET request to slash to-do. And you can see here we get an array of both of the to-dos that we have because we're still running the server, they're still in memory, and everything still works. So, and you can see we do get a GET to slash to-do 200. Good to go.